Saturday mornings from 10 a.m. to 12 noon on Classic Radio 105.5, 105.9, Hot FM 98.5, 98.7, GBN TV, and all their social media platforms. The only totally local music program in Grenada, representing all genres of music. So it's Greenz Music to the World on Saturday mornings from 10 a.m. to 12 noon on GBN with the music icon himself, Mr. Eugene Gittens. See you then.
Music to the World is brought to you by Gittens Pharmacare, the pharmacy that cares. Halifax Street, St. George's. Natural Cool, Spiceland Mall, Grandance. Cool clothes for cool people. The Computer Store, Grenada Limited, Spiceland Mall, Grandance. The Gamers Paradise, with headsets by Razer, Conair, JBL, Sony, Astro, Logitech, and more. And Island Catering, without a doubt, the best food and catering service on the island. Pharmacare, the pharmacy that cares. Halifax Street, St. George's. Affordable access to care, a wide range of prescription drugs, medical supplies, health and beauty items, diabetic testing supplies, immune system support products, vitamins, supplements, and lots more. Visit us today or call 440-2165. Ask about or call in prescriptions, discounted items, and special delivery requests. Gittens Pharmacare. Care, convenience, expertise. We've got it all.
Heaven, oh yeah. Our Father, who art in heaven, oh yeah. He gave us the moon by night and the sun by day.
Good morning, Grenada, and welcome to Greenz Music to the World, wherever you're listening. Wherever you're listening in the world. Yeah. My name is Eugene Gittens, and I've got a great show lined up for you, as usual. We got some very, very special guests, and I'll be introducing them in a while. In the meantime, let's take a little prayer to start things off. The music of Kevin Peterkin, Our Father.
Heavenly Father, Heavenly Father.
He make me jump in a joy. Everybody stand up, the enemy get destroyed. Instant for Jah love, we giving praise to the Lord. Everybody hand up for whatever till me die. And me now going to back up. May the sun my day, may the moon my night. Every day change, so just hold on tight. Every day me wake up and open up my eyes. On my knees me give him praise one time. Hear me say, Our Father.
Yeah, just making sure I'm getting all my levels right, so I can hear myself well, hear the music right, and everything is good. Yeah, much better now. Right. So, I was saying we got a great show lined up for you. We'll be talking to Grenadian-American artist who has been heating up the place with a hot, hot song. It's called Kuchidango. And her name, of course, is Dionne Blaize. She's got some Kariakou roots. We'll be talking to her about that as well. We also have a veteran in the reggae and African music scene. He lives here in Grenada. He was around Mango Island Records as A&R person. That's Artist and Repertoire, a division of Mango Records. And his name is Mr. Jerry Rappaport, so we'll be talking with him as well. So don't go anywhere, right? I want to say thanks to the man JC and also Graphics for keeping us company all morning. I also want to say hi to Timon, that's Timon Parrott over there in Master Control, and Ms. Janelle McDonald for co-hosting with me last week. That was a really informative program we had last week with Dr. Nurse and Dr. Smith. And if you missed that program, it is available on the GBN website and on the Greenz Music to the World Facebook page. Actually, it's on the GBN Facebook page and the Greenz Music to the World Facebook page. So check that out. Really good information about the creative arts and copyright. Also, Dr. Smith. Okay, let's just. Dr. Smith, when she spoke last week, she talked about the Caribbean Music Industry Survey, and that is now available. It's been circulated. It has been circulated, and again, I'm going to put it on the Greenz Music to the World Facebook page, so you can access it there. She recommends that anybody in the industry fill out the survey because it would help inform policy in the Caribbean region. So please, if you're involved in any way, an artist or musician or producer or just any where you fit into that creative industry, please go find that survey and fill it out. Again, it's on the I'll put it on the Greenz Music to the World Facebook page, and while you're there, like the page and follow the page, because we want to also get you on there as well, because we put all our briefings and all our notes and all our updates on that page. Want to say hi to all my sponsors as usual. You heard them up at the top of the program. So one of them I want to just say hi to in particular, because they don't have a number in their ad. I want to say hi to the folks down there at Island Catering. So I want to say hi to Patrick and Steve and Raquel and everybody down there and all the staff at Island Catering. As you know, they make the best food. And their number to call if you want to order anything anytime. They've got specials, daily specials, Monday to Friday. And they've got stuff on Saturday if you call in advance as well, and Sunday, special orders. So you want to reach them at 444-2374 and 439-2374. And of course, they've got pickup or delivery options. There's some people I want to some special people I want to shout out. Starting with Kimron Corian. He's the guy behind I Am Grenadian, that great site. And Kimron, you know, much enough respect to you. Thank you, my brother, for all you do. Gary Lozon, Nazim Benjamin, Brian, Lindsay Campbell, Seth Noel, Jerry Hopkin, Harold Paisley, and of course to all of you, my listeners. Stay tuned in. The beautiful guitar on that track you're listening to, again, it's called Our Father by Kevin Peterkin, and the guitar is done by Ron Downs. He plays with a police band here, a great guitarist. Nice R&B song. Okay, so all that stuff out of the way, we're going to start the program officially. I just want to say one thing. A couple of weeks ago, Jude Natty Henry sent a video to me, and it got lost in all the videos I received, and it got lost. And I heard this week that he had passed. The song was called, or is called, the video he sent to me is called Tribute to the Frontliners, and he was paying tribute to all our frontline workers in the advent of COVID. And so this morning, I'd like to start the program doing two things. I want to send out his tribute to the frontline workers by playing his song, and I also want to make this a tribute to him as well, one of the many tributes that he has already received and will continue to receive. Jude Natty Henry, one of our fellow musicians here on Ireland who has gone to the great beyond. So here we go. Tribute to the frontline workers, Jude Natty Henry.
This song is dedicated to all frontliners, healthcare workers, nurses and doctors all around the world. Yeah!
Enough respect to the frontliners. the nurses and doctors, the healthcare workers. In this war, you are the heroes. Enough respect to the frontliners, the nurses and doctors, the healthcare workers. In this war, you are the heroes. There is nothing more dangerous than the coronavirus. Nothing more cantankerous than the coronavirus. All who forget to put Jah first, let them know that it is a must. I and I are well conscious, in Almighty Jah we put our trust. Enough respect to the frontliners, the nurses and doctors, the healthcare workers. In this war you are the heroes. We love you for the sacrifice you make, yes. We love you for the chances that you take now. We love you for serving on the front line, yeah. We love you and we are close behind. Enough respect to the frontliners, the nurses and doctors, the healthcare workers. In this war you are the heroes. Let's clap for the frontliners. Let's clap for the healthcare workers. Feel the frontliners, them are the bravest warriors. The nurses and doctors, them are the real heroes. Enough respect to the frontliners, the nurses and doctors, the healthcare workers. In this war you are the heroes. They must stand up and face the fight against that power and might of that force which is out of sight, while others cower with fright. Let us show our appreciation by giving them an applauding hand. This song of dedication, let us all sing along. Enough respect to the frontliners, the nurses and doctors, the healthcare workers. In this war you are the heroes. Frontliners, first responders, nurses and doctors, all healthcare workers, we dedicate this song to you, to let you know that we love you. We dedicate this song so true, to let you know that we love you.
Frontliners, Jude Natty Henry, deceased. Yes, to all the frontline workers from Jude. Another song I want to play before we get into our guests and talking to our guests, that is. I want to play a song I received yesterday. It's by a young lady called Tavisha Antwine, and she's from the Boca Secondary School, or maybe she just graduated from the Boca Secondary School. And this video was dedicated to the 2020 graduating class of that school. It's called Reflections, or I'll Remember You. And of course, the music was done by a teacher there, Godson Brung, good buddy of mine. Real nice track, so I want to share it with you.
We've been through a lot, my friend. And paints the sea has parts to find where our new journey starts. I know we will find a way. And yes, this day has come so fast. All our fun has come to pass, but memories will stay. Because jobs that we want, and when we're down, who will have our backs to get us back on track and help us think beyond? Though it pains to see us part, to find where our new journey starts, I know we will find a way. And yes, this day has come so fast, all our fun has come to pass, but memories will stay.
Song, nice melody, very catchy, loving it, from the Walker Secondary School. And you know, that school has a lot of great music program, so we don't expect anything less. Right, so right about now, we want to start with chatting with one of our guests. Well, not really chat with her first. We're going to play her song first, and then we're going to chat with her, Dionne Blaize, with that hot, hot song, Coochie Dango. So we're going to play the video, and then we'll come back and chat with Dionne. Coochie Dango. Let's hear Coochie Dango. Yeah, Master Control, we want to hear. Let's see what's happening over there. Some of you have a little technical difficulty, maybe. Master Control, Coochie Dango. Don't know if it's not playing or something.
If I tell you I love you, tell me what you're going to do. If you are the oxygen I need to survive, I can't live without you. Oh baby, with your body, come tease my body. Da-di-da-di-da, tum-tum-da-da-di. Stuck on you, I don't need nobody. Da-di-da-di-da, ta-ta-da-di-da. Ain't nothing better than you, because I got my eyes on you. Ain't nothing better than you, because you make my days brand new. Boy, oh, yeah, boy. Make a dance, Coochie Dango. Oh, oh, Coochie Dango. Boy, oh, yo, make a dance, Coochie Dango. Oh, oh, Coochie Dango. Boy, oh, yo, make a dance, Coochie Dango. Oh, oh, yeah, Coochie Dango. best, of course. Give me that thing, come wine and pass. The way you miss on me mind, oh, I'm gonna love you today, not tomorrow. Some people they say, Dionne, oh, it's got to my brain, oh, yeah. But loving you, oh, is all I wanna do, oh. You make me groove to the sound of the bass line. Whoa, to the bass line. Give me the groove, baby, wine, check my waistline. Whoa, check my waistline.
Boy, oh, you wanna make a dance, coochie don't go.
Oh, itchy don't go.
Boy, oh, you wanna make a dance, coochie don't go.
What you going to do if you are the oxygen I need to survive? I can't live without you. It's a special kind of feeling where you're running, baby. Special type of a vibe, and I feel like dancing. Could you don't go? Oh, yeah, yeah, ain't nothing better than you. Because I got my eyes on you, ain't nothing better than you. For you make my days brand new.
Oh, yeah, oh, yeah, make a dance. Could you don't go?
Yeah, Kuchidongo. Wow, that's a hot one. Beautiful, beautiful video, beautiful song. And we have in-house, well, by joining us by Zoom from New York, the singer of the song, Dionne Blaize. Dionne, good morning.
Pleasant good morning to you, Eugene.
It's good to have you on the program.
And all of the listeners.
Yes, yes. How are things up there in New York?
Along.
Mm-hmm. What's the date? What's
it? I mean, we still haven't gotten where we need to be yet, but you know,
mm-hmm.
We're all in here doing the best we can, you know?
Of course. So we're here to talk about Kuchidongo. Well, let's start at the very beginning. What is that Kuchidongo thing all about?
Yeah, Kuchidongo is about a beat.
It's about a beat.
It's on the beat, yes. Mm-hmm. And dancing to that beat.
Dancing to the beat, okay. It's about a beat. Well, you know, it really is an infectious beat. It is very, very catchy song. And I think everybody who's hearing it is loving it. So thank you for all that. But tell us about...
Well, I would like to say thank you for having me on your show. And I would like to personally thank you for all of your contributions to helping artists like myself and others, you know, and promoting music and just in general. Promoting Grenada. Big up to you.
Yeah, thank you for that. I appreciate it. You know, have been a musician and myself, you know, that makes a difference. So I feel it and I know it, you know. I know the struggles. So yeah, so listen, you are a Grenadian American artist. Your roots are in Carriacou. And
yes.
You are a Blaize. So the first question I guess everybody would ask is, were you related to Herbert Blaize?
The answer to that question is a big fat yes.
I figured a big fat yes.
Yes, that's my cousin. That was my cousin, yes.
Nice, nice.
My father and him were first cousins.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. And I also mentioned to you when I spoke to you yesterday that a good buddy of mine is George Blaize. He is also the... one of the sponsors of this program, his company, him and his wife's company, the computer store, they're one of the sponsors of this program. So I'm sticking with the Blazes. So yeah.
All connected.
All connected.
It was so funny when you mentioned that to me yesterday, and I just laughed because we're all connected. It's just amazing to me.
yeah. So tell me about Kuchidongo. The beat. It sounds like it is an Afro beat.
Yes, it's an Afro beat.
And where did the rhythm come from?
It comes from the producer Agopa Butterfly. They're stationed in Namibia. Namibia.
Namibia. That's in southern Africa.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And I would just like to give a big shout out to them because they're tuned in listening.
Oh, cool. Very cool.
Yeah.
And I guess you've been connected to them by Zoom, as everybody these days. And
Thank God for modern technology. We were able to get this record done, you know?
Mm-hmm. When you first heard the beat, what did you think?
I fell in love with it instantly. I was like, this is hot, you know? They were kind of nervous about presenting it to me, but I was excited from the moment I heard it.
Mm-hmm. And is that the time where the Kuchi Dongo kind of idea came, or it took a little while before that came?
Well, it's so funny. I want to big up my friend Shlango because he's the one that introduced me to Sula. And I had told him, he's an African artist from Namibia. And I was telling him how I really love Afro-pop music because it reminds me so much of Caribbean music.
Oh, yes.
So he was like, okay, I'm going to hook you up with my peoples. And that's how it got started, you know. So, you know, Sula and I, we talked and I told him what I'm looking for. And so they wrote this great record. And when they sent it to me, I was like, wow. I was so excited, you know, I couldn't wait to do it. And so here you have a finished product that took a lot of time to get done because initially when we started, it was at the heart of COVID when New York was completely shut down.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That must have had its challenges, huh?
Oh,
yeah.
It was a lot of obstacles in the way, but yeah, we plugged through and we got it done.
Mm-hmm. And the video, tell us about the video, how you got a video done.
Okay, well, we did that in New York, and I want to big up the videographer, Brian K. Roberts, and all of the staff that was involved, like my stylist, Brian Wilson, and the makeup artist, Emily Illy. I mean, Brian, the stylist, if you could see all the beautiful colors and schemes of the outfits in there, he did a remarkable job on that. And the staff and the cast and crew. The choreographer, Chris White, it was just like a collective unit of people that came together and made such a great product that I'm so proud to represent.
Oh, I totally love the outfits. It's so Afrocentric. It so fits the beat and the music. It all just comes together to me, you know, everything, the words, the lyrics, the video. It's all really wonderfully done. And kudos to you and your team for doing that, you know. And
Thank you so much.
Yeah, we're gonna make sure we big this song up. This is a big song. This has to be a huge song. So I'll do my
Thank
best on
so
I'll do my best on this end. But tell me, you look like you're a good dancer, right? Or did you have to learn the steps of this one?
I can do my thing. I can do a little something, you know. I mean, I'm not a professional dancer. Mm-hmm. I didn't go to professional dancing school, but I have some rhythm in me, you know.
Well, you come from Grenada and Caracol, you better have some rhythm in you, right?
We got to represent.
I hear you. Did you have some professional dancers in there as well? Some of those guys were doing some really nice moves and stuff.
Everybody was carefully selected.
Mm-hmm.
And Chris White, he's amazing. He did a wonderful job in working with me and getting the dances together, the rehearsals. Like I said, we had to be so careful because there were restrictions in New York, you know, to get the rehearsals together. But we did it. Somehow we got it. We got it done.
So Dionne, you've been in the music business for how long now? When you started getting into it seriously?
Well, I kind of been in and out. Like when Harold Pisidy interviewed me for my premiere, big up to Harold.
Mm-hmm.
He was asking me that question. So, you know, I did start off, you know, doing music, and then I took a long break.
Uh-huh.
Wondering, like, why was there such a big gap? And I told him just personal stuff, you know, personal everyday life.
Of course, it happens.
But I never lost the passion for it. So, you know, here I am again.
Back at it.
Plugging away.
Right. And this time you come real strong. You come real heavy this time, huh? Real hard.
But it's so funny that you asked that question because I had forgotten when we talked yesterday that my godfather, Franklin Blaze, he was the one that initially brought me into a studio for the very first time, like in 2000 and I want to say 4 or 5.
Mm-hmm.
And that was my first experience with actually being in a professional recording studio and actually doing some work. And I fell in love with it. I was so fascinated with it.
It's so easy to fall in love with music, and that's, you know, it's just such a creative place to be, studios and around music and all that, especially for someone who like us, you know, who enjoy it. But tell me, your dad was a big influence in your music, wasn't he?
Oh, absolutely. I watched your documentary, and you noted that you started at a very young age and that your parents had a lot to do with you, you know, breaking into music. Me too. You know, my dad, he taught himself how to play the piano. I mean, he grew up poor in Caracou. You know, he couldn't afford a teacher, and he self-taught himself. And I'm so proud of him and his accomplishments. May he rest in peace. And so I grew up watching him play. And then also I have an uncle, Fimba Joseph, who was a local wicked bass player for a band in England. And then when he migrated to the States, he introduced reggae music to me. I was like maybe about 5 or 6 years old, and he would play all types of reggae music. And I fell in love with Bob Marley and all types of music. I just love Caribbean music and the culture. It's such a wonderful thing, you know?
Of course, of course. It's our thing. So would reggae be kind of like one of your favorite genres?
One of them. One of them. I initially started off doing R&B, believe it or not, but I couldn't stray away from the Caribbean side of me and the roots. So if you notice, you'll see
of course
the different variations of music I've done over the years.
You know, Dionne, let's take a break. Let's take a break from the talk, because there's a music program. We're gonna play another one of your videos. This time, I think I like to play, which is the one I have selected. Partial Love, Dionne.
Oh yeah, that's
Blaize.
One of my favorites.
It is. Oh, there you go. Partial Love. So we're gonna get that video, and then we'll come back to the conversation. above your computer screen. My screen where I'm seeing your video is over your head, so I'm kind of gazing out there. But I love the track, Partial Love. It's not what you're looking for, the full thing or nothing at all. Hold on, let me get you up. We missed your response there. Go ahead.
I said all or nothing.
All or nothing.
No partial
love. I hear you. Yeah, so you were talking about your dad and his influence on the music, and you're talking about some of the genres you like, R&B. Who are some of the singers you like, R&B singers you like?
Well, my favorite singer of all time is Whitney Houston.
Whitney, makes sense.
She was my inspiration, like, forget it. And once I heard her, I was like, oh my God, you know?
Amazing.
There's so many of like great R&B singers, but like, she, I have to say, is my favorite out of them all. But I love them all.
I hear you.
And I listen to all types of music, so.
Of course, as musicians and singers, we gotta listen to everything, you know? You can't limit yourself. But also, let's take some other genres. Reggae, who's like some of your favorite one? Your favorite female artist and your favorite male artist? I think Bob Marley probably sounds like that was a big influence in your life.
I love Bob Marley, and I think everybody can agree to that, but there's so many other great. You know, speaking of reggae, I work with Ed, you know.
Ed Robinson. Yes.
I want to big him up too.
Of course.
That track that you just played, he produced that.
I know that. The one with Jude Natty Henry.
We did that record together.
Pardon? Which one? You mean the one, Partial Love?
Partial Love, yeah.
And guess what? The track I played at the very top, recognizing Jude Natty Henry, I think I saw credits. He got a credits for the video on that one as well. Ed Robinson.
Actually, he's the producer of the Partial Love video, not the video, just the music part of it. Brian K. Wilson, he's the same videographer that shot Coochie Dungo. Mm-hmm. He's the one that actually helped me put the video together for Partial Love.
Yeah.
Ed was the music producer.
I got you, but I was referring to the song I played at the very top. Maybe you couldn't hear it.
I couldn't hear it.
So let's skip that. So tell me the name of two of your favorite female reggae artists.
I like Cynthia Slosh. Uh-huh. Oh my God, I'm so terrible with names. The one that the artist that sings "Someone Loves You, Honey."
Uh-huh. Someone around. I can't remember.
My voice is kind of out today because of the allergies. But you know, I forgot her name. I'm terrible.
Yeah, I can't remember either.
Forgive me, folks, but I love her. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's a lot of people I love, and you know, but Bob Marley, I love Bearse Hammond, Jacqueur.
Yeah, a whole bunch of them. So many artists.
Just to name a few, I mean, even some of the greats that's passed on, Dennis Brown. I mean, there's so many great reggae artists. Mm-hmm. I mean, I could just name, like, keep going, you know, on and on.
So tell me, though, coming back to Coochie Dango, which is really, really the talk of today, what are the plans for the song, for performances, I know it's COVID times, but what are the plans for the future of that song?
Oh, well, the sky's the limit. I mean, we're going to push this record all the way, you know, nonstop. We're not going to stop. I mean, even with what's going on globally with COVID, you know, it's set back a lot of artists over the last year, you know, with doing shows, making the money that they're accustomed to making. But things have to get better. And I think music is inspirational to everyone. Mm-hmm. And this is the time when we really need to hear this good music. With all the things that we've gone through. So I think people will appreciate the fact that there are artists out there still trying to, you know, make great music for them to enjoy, even if it's in the comfort of their own homes.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm hopeful that one day we'll all be able to come back out again and dance. And I can hear this song playing in the clubs, at a barbecue, you know?
Of course, absolutely.
You know, I hear it playing, so I'm looking forward to that.
Well, we're going to make sure it gets played down here. You know, it's got to start somewhere, and we're going to start it where it belongs, home.
I'm sorry, her name came to me. I think it's J.C. Hodge.
J.C. Lodge.
I can't remember. I had like a memory. Like,
Telephone Love. She sang Telephone Love as well. J.C. Lodge. Oh, yeah.
I love her. I love her voice.
Oh, yeah. So, I think, you know, with this song, I was saying, You've covered the continent. So you in the U.S., we have Grenada covered here. We're going to cover you here in Grenada with that song. And then you got Namibia all the way down there in Southern Africa covered. So, I mean, already the song is going to be, it's hitting that, you know, couple.
Yes, absolutely.
Three parts of the world already, just like that.
Dula, they're definitely going to get that record played in different African countries. That's for sure.
Yeah. So, I hear you also like our jab jab and soca beats. So you're a jab jab person, right? Which was the last carnival? When were you here last for carnival? A couple of years ago?
Oh my God. Well, the last time I was in Grenada was probably in 2013, but it wasn't during carnival. I would say 2011 is the last time I think I participated in jab, and I miss it so much. Well,
Dionne, that's a long time, you know.
So. I hope they have carnival next year. I really, because I will be there for sure.
Great.
Please,
great.
God, I would.
Great. Well, yeah, we'd love to have you back home.
That would be so wonderful.
Yeah, and by that time, I'm sure Kuchi Dongo will be everywhere in the world.
Yes.
So, let's take a note. Is there anybody you want to say hi to in Grenada while you're here on the program?
Well, I would like to thank some people, mm-hmm. you know, that have been working to help assist with this project alongside yourself. So I'm bigging you up again.
Thank you, Eugene.
And I'm so glad that you brought that up. So I would like to thank all of the people who have supported me, especially for my premiere. I'd like to big them up again. Natasha Von Castle, and she's a music industry with VP Records and L3 Magazine. Mm-hmm. You have Burgess, Quaco McPhee, The Mighty Sparrow, mm-hmm. Tall Cree, Mandela Lynx, Miney, Inspector, Mr. Legs, Kelvin Jacob from mm-hmm. the CEO of Spice Mask Corporation, Ricardo Keynes Douglas, Richie Richardson, who's a designer, Alma Boy Roberts, Cheryl V, mm-hmm. Lednick, Ross Valley, Gentle Benjamin, and Casey Benjamin, Otea, she's an artist in Namibia.
Nice.
And also Zingo. I would like to thank Jerry Hopkin, my manager. Big up to Jerry. Junior George. I lost my thought now. Junior George. Harold Paxity. All of my staff that work with me, my stylist, Brian Wilson, the videographer, Brian K. Wilson, the choreographer, Chris White, and all the beautiful, amazing dancers, everybody in the cast and crew that partook in this video, shooting of this video, and all of the sponsors like Ride Along, Caribbean Times Newspaper, GBN TV and Radio, Wild FM, Crossroad Family, 999 Radio, Caribbean Power Station, Agopa, Butterfly, of course, I gotta big you guys up again. Mm-hmm. And that's it, I think. And also Ed Robinson, like I said, he was a big mentor for me, and he helped to cultivate me into who I am today. So I'd like to big him up and thank him personally.
Yeah.
I can't think of anyone else, and I hope I'm not forgetting anyone, because you know sometimes people are like, okay, she didn't mention me. But if I didn't mention you, it doesn't mean that you're not important. It's just that sometimes when you're on the spot,
that happens. Yeah.
I thank everyone who took a vested interest in me and in this project.
Yeah. Well, what I would say is that, you know, when something is good, it's good. And, you know, I listen to a lot of music, and if I hear a song that does what that song does to me, instantly like that, I know it's good. I just heard that song the first time, and I say, that's going to be a hit. Or that could be a hit. The rest is up to us. You know, we make the hits. And so we got to just believe in ourselves and believe in our artists like you. And you've done the work. You've put in the time. You've given us something really good. So now we've got to just run with it. And I would certainly help as much as I can on this end, because it's a really great
thank
track.
Thank you so much. I appreciate you greatly. Yeah. And I've gotten a lot of love and support. All of the people I mentioned, I mean, the kind of love that it was like... amazing. It can make me cry. I'm serious. I'm like so deeply touched by all of the artists and music industry professionals that have been stepping up and bigging me up. All the DJs that's already playing at radio stations. And you too. I mean, this is wonderful. I feel blessed. That's all I can say is thank you.
Yeah. Dionne, it's been absolutely pleasure, absolutely a pleasure chatting with you and playing your song. And thank you for sharing your song to me, with me and the world. We appreciated your beautiful voice and all the energy you bring, you know, and your beauty. You're just a beautiful person.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Eugene.
So thank you so much. And we're going to go out playing another one of your songs that I like as well. It's called Give It My All.
Okay.
Yeah?
That's an inspirational song.
Yeah, very inspirational. So Give It My All. And good talking to you. You can stick around to another guest if you want. Feel free to stick around, or if you have to go, we understand. So Dionne, take care, and really nice talking to you. Give It My All. American artist with that hot new song Cuchidango. And if you haven't volume, which you must have just heard it. But go out there and play it, get the video, like it, stream it, download it. We got to make that song big. It's our girl, right? We're going to make her big. Yeah, so I've got on Zoom now my second guest, Mr. Jerry Rappaport. Jerry, you there? Say hello, man.
Yes, good morning, Eugene. Good morning, everybody that's out there. Thanks for having me on, Eugene.
Well, yeah, Jerry, I know you're no stranger to TV. I mean, you're always on TV in some capacity or the other. So you're right.
I don't know, as enjoyable as this will be, honestly.
Right, I hear that. But music is always fun, so it's good to have a little fun sometime. So, yeah, Jerry, we got so much to talk about. We may have to limit what we're going to talk about. But, Jerry, the first thing I want to just mention is that tell the people a little bit about your connection to Island / Mongo Records and what you did back in that time, of that part of your career.
In the mid 80s, I was hired by Island Records to revive their Mango Records label, doing A&R initially, and then ultimately I became the head of the label. And at the time, Island had been, after the death of Bob, had been somewhat, I'd say, dormant when it came to things like reggae music. I don't think that Chris Blackwell was very keen on dancehall. I think he was much more of a roots kind of a guy. And when he brought me back into Run Mango, initially the emphasis of the label was mostly on African music and other musics from, but which at that point was being defined as world music. And it was only after about a year or so that we started getting back into reggae again, which was great because we made some connections with some people in Jamaica that were starting, some roots music was starting to bubble up again. And that's what we got involved with.
And just
so
for,
I was at Island.
Go ahead. No, you go.
I was at Island doing that for about 5 or 6 years, and then I left, and then I was brought back by PolyGram a few years after that. Who had purchased Island Records, actually, and I was brought in to redo their catalog and sort of oversee the transferring of things to CD, because initially, I don't think a lot of people realize this, but the initial days of CDs, most of the time, there was no artistic involvement, in the sense that quite often what happened with record labels, they sent in an order, work order to the plant, and some guy went down into the vault and pulled the tape off the shelf to use it as a master. And half of the time they were using like cassette masters and just really inappropriate sources. So we then sort of embarked on a project to go back to the original vinyl sources and do proper reissues and get the catalog back to where it should be. And that also included Legend, which when I first got the Island, interesting enough, Bob Marley's Legend record didn't have the original mixes on it. It had these sort of quasi-disco mixes, which had a straight four and a four kind of rhythm to them. And I remember I walked into Chris's office and I said, you know, what is this? You know, this is like ridiculous. You know, I mean, you know, we got to change this around. And we changed it around. And next thing you knew, the record went on to be one of the biggest catalog selling records of all time. And it's the only platinum record that I still have, that I keep in my house, because it really means a lot to me. So I think that record has a place in the world that's very unique.
Mm-hmm. You know, for the listeners who don't know the history, Island Records is the record company owned by Jamaican Chris Blackwell that took reggae from the ghetto of Jamaica and made it into an international music. And of course, Bob Marley was their main artist, but they had many other artists. Actually, I think Chris Blackwell's first success internationally was with Millie Small. My Boy Lollipop was the song, and he did many other genres of music as well. We'll talk about, I'll ask Jerry about that. But there's a story about both Chris Blackwell and Richard Branson. And Jerry, you could tell me if this is correct, but I've heard that Chris Blackwell started of selling records from the back of his car in selling reggae records, Jamaican reggae records from the back of his car in the UK. And that was really where he began. And tell me that that's correct.
Yes, he was selling records out of the boot of his car in Piccadilly Circus. And he was responsible. He was the first source to really reliably bring in Jamaican records into the UK. Mm-hmm. And as a result of that, you know, I think as many people realize, I mean, reggae became sort of the black music of the UK. Mm-hmm. And it has a place in UK culture that's very different from, for instance, the place that it holds in America, North America.
Sure.
From there, and he also was involved with Trojan Records in the beginning, which put out most of the ska stuff at the time and rock steady stuff. And then he started Island Records. And the rest is history. I mean, you know, Chris was a visionary. You know, I mean, he was extremely proud of his Jamaican heritage. But he also saw where it could fit in the world, you know, and the fact that, you know, when he signed the Wailers, you know, when Bob Bunny and Peter were stuck in London and they didn't have any money to get back to the UK, and they walked into the Island Records office and basically said to Chris, you know, give us £6,000 and we'll send you a record. And Chris gave him the money, and everybody else in the office thought he was mad. They just thought that they would never see the money again. They said, you know, they were a bunch of rude boys. You know, you ain't gonna see that money. And about 6 months later, Catch a Fire arrived in the mail, you know, and the rest is history.
Right.
And Chris had the vision to be able to see what made Bob so special, you know. And this is not in any way, shape, or form meant to denigrate Bunny or Peter in any way, you know, at all. But Bob, there was something about Bob that transcended everything else. You know, there was just an aura about him.
The charisma.
There's very few people you encounter in the world or in music or anything. You know, there's a handful of them that are the true visionaries, the ones that are game changers, you know, and Bob was definitely one of them. And he will probably go down in history as probably the most popular musician of the 20th century.
Songwriting ability, charisma, the whole works. But I'm talking about Chris. The other side of Chris, while Chris was doing his stuff with Island Records, it's interesting. Richard Branson was doing his stuff. He started with records also. The great Sir Richard Branson had Virgin Records and started off, I understand, much the same way, very humble beginnings like Chris, in terms of, you know, starting off the label that way. But tell me if that's the case or not. I noticed you're kind of like, not quite.
No disrespect meant to Richard Branson, but I think that, you know, Chris was the model, you know, and Island Records was the model. And Virgin was very much, you know, trying to follow in the footsteps of Island Records. For instance, Virgin pretty much stayed in the rock world for most of their career. They had, you know, they hired Jumbo Van Reernen in the 70s, I guess, to start the Virgin Frontline series. Jumbo went on to become my counterpart at Island, running Mango out of the UK. But Jumbo's another one of this sort of unsung heroes of reggae, because Jumbo was just a fantastic A&R guy. I mean, besides being just an exceptional human being and somebody he died a few years ago and was a great loss. But what he did at Virgin, the kinds of acts that he was signing for a label that ultimately didn't have somebody at the top like, you know, Chris, is pretty exceptional. I mean, the thing that I spoiled me for working at Island Records is the fact that Chris didn't really always care about how viable a record was commercially. It mattered, but what really mattered was good music, you know, and that's a rarity in a commodity driven world.
True. Jerry, we're going to talk a little bit about some of the songs you've worked on and play some of the tracks you've worked on, but I want to just, for the artists here, the people listening here who you know, artists and musicians and stuff. You let's talk a little bit about A&R, artists and repertoire. You were the A&R guy for part of your career. So explain to them what an A&R person does at a record company, one, and how has that role changed in modern in today's world, in today's music industry? So the traditional and how has it changed?
Yeah. Well, traditionally, I mean, the origins of the term A&R dates back to the 1930s, because back in the 1930s, in the nascent days of the recording industry, most singers were not songwriters. So an A&R guy is basically a talent scout, is what we are. And so back then, they were responsible for finding artists to record songs, and they were also responsible for finding songs. And that's why if you listen to somebody like a Billie Holiday, for instance, one of the top singers in the 1930s, every once in a while, you'll hear Billie singing a song that you'll go, geez, that's a really weak song. And the reason for it is because the A&R guys knew that if you were going to get the really A songs, sometimes you had to take a B song from a songwriter to get the A one.
Right, okay. Right.
So that's sort of the genesis of it. But, you know, by the time I got involved in A&R in the 80s, it was really the role that you played in the record company was you went out and found the act, and then you had to sell it. First, you had to sell it within your company. You know, you were the advocate for the artist. You had to go in, fight for the budgets to do proper recordings and videos, but also fight to make sure that your promotion staff and your publicity department were aware of the acts you were working on. And that was an issue that I encountered many times at Island when we were trying to cross over acts out of the reggae world into the more mainstream world. And I would deal with guys in promotion and A&R, promotion and publicity, that were more used to dealing with acts like U2. Than acts like Shelley Thunder or an Oswald or a Beatmon Experience. And when we got into, you know, trying to sell African music and non-English music in America, it was a real challenge. I mean, there's been a handful of non-English hit songs in America at that point. There was like literally, you could count them on one hand, probably the missing two fingers. And I think that's the part of the job that people don't realize is that you're the one that's the point person in the record company fighting for that act.
Mm-hmm.
All right. What it's morphed into today, I think it's pretty much the same. I couldn't tell you 100% for that, in all honesty, Eugene, because I'm not sort of in touch with that world now.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I started out in the music business when we were using still 3-track and 4-track machines. So, you know, I was able to adapt to the fact that the first time I walked in and saw a 64-track board, and all I could think was, we don't really need about 60 of those tracks, do we? You know, I saw some of the best music I've ever heard in my life recorded on 3-track and 4-track machines. In the end of the day, technology is a wonderful thing. But in the end of the day, you either got the chops or you don't.
Mm-hmm.
I know you as a musician know that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't know if you've ever seen the Ginger Baker documentary. Ginger Baker was the drummer for Cream. Mm-hmm. He played with Fela at one point. But Ginger Baker had a great thing. And, you know, his way he approached life was, you know, if you ask him, well, what do you think about this person? He'd either say, oh, he can keep time. Or he'd go, oh, they couldn't keep time. And he'd just dismiss them. You know, so, you know, in the end of the day, it's about talent. You can't, technology can't mask talent.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's nothing that can duplicate the place of talent.
I hear that. And in terms of the A&R guys today, I think what they do a lot of is sort of scout the internet rather than going to the clubs, you know, like how you did in your time, scout the internet, see who's, you know, who's got a billion hits or who's streaming well and who's got, you know, all those kind of things, the mega data, they look at the data and the analytics. Go ahead.
It's a lot easier to deal with. I mean, when I was doing A&R, I mean, I was out, you know, 5-6 nights a week.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'd be out until, you know, I'd get home at, you know, 3-4 o'clock in the morning half of the time. I had to be in the office by around 9 or 10, you know, and it was a grind. You know, the payoff was that every once in a while you saw something that just, you went, whoa. and said to yourself, I got to sign this. I got to get to work with this person. And when you saw somebody's career develop and take off, I mean, it's a great feeling that you've been able to help that person get the kind of recognition that they deserve.
Jerry, who was one of those artists that you saw the very first time and, you know, you went like, whoa. It's like, you know, my reaction to Coochie Dongo's song. Who was one of those artists that you saw that you kind of remember, like you say, wow, this person, that's a breakthrough artist immediately?
Well, I would say there were three. The first one was before my working in the industry in that capacity. It was when I saw the Wailers for the first time in July of 73 in New York at Max's Kansas City. And I just, I'll never forget it. I mean, it was interesting enough, Bunny Wailer wasn't on the tour because he didn't want to fly. So Joe Higgs took Bunny's place. I had no idea who Joe Higgs was at the time. It was years later that I connected the dots and realized how fortunate I had been to have an opportunity to see Joe perform live. But it was, you know, it was a life-changing experience. I mean, I walked out of that club that night and I was like, I was done. You know, like I just knew that was the music that I had to learn more about and I had to get involved with it. And that's what I pushed through.
Jerry, just to share with you, that was the same experience I had the first time I saw Bob Marley. It was just, I never saw anything like it before. So same experience.
Do you know anybody that doesn't have that same experience? You know what I mean? I mean, I've seen a lot of incredible music in my life. I was really blessed in that regard that I grew up in New York at a time when one of the top clubs when I was a teenager lost their liquor license because Lenny Bruce, the comedian, got busted for obscenity and they lost their liquor license. So a 14-year-old kid like myself could go in there, you know, and sit and hear just incredible music every night, you know. And getting back to the question that you asked, I mean, the two groups that really that I can think of that in my career that sort of had that effect was Boucman Experience, Haitian band that I worked with. The first time I saw them, I was like, wow, this is unbelievable. I mean, they were doing a music that was, for lack of a better term, was called voodoo rock. It took elements of traditional voodoo influenced music, Haitian music, and combined it with contemporary beats and whatnot. And they were just incredible. They just, their presence. And I signed them and we had a really good run and I became very close with them and they're still active. They've been very active in throughout the situation in Haiti for years. And the other person was somebody who I half signed. It was somebody, a Brazilian artist named Carlinhos Brown, who I saw when I went down to Brazil in 1990 to try to do a record with Gilberto Gil. And unfortunately, the night, as I was in transit, Gil's son was in an accident, car accident, he later died. So we never got to do the record, but I got to meet the percussionist in Caetano Veloso's band at the time, who was an 18-year-old kid named Carlinhos Brown from Salvador and Bahia. And he already had 300 songs that he had written. He was an incredible percussionist. He played guitar. He had the look. He had everything. I mean, it was just one of those moments where you go, you know, it's like you feel like you found the Rosetta Stone or something.
Right, right.
And I went back to New York, and Chris didn't quite get it. Or else he didn't feel there were other things he thought that were more important. So we sort of sat on the back burner for about 6 months. And then Denny Cordell came in and became the head of A&R. And one night we were sitting and hanging out and he turned to me and he said, what have you been working on or heard or that you think is really it? And I played him the Carlinhos Brown stuff and he just went, wow, we need to sign this guy. So we started the deal process, but unfortunately I left island halfway through the deal and then they decided not to go forward with the deal because I wasn't going to be there. And he got signed by Virgin in France and became an international star. His carnival group Timbalada is one of the top carnival groups in Bahia now, and he's just an incredible artist, and to this day I regret the fact that we didn't get a chance to make records together.
I hear you. You win some and you lose some, right, in the business.
Yeah, well, that's the nature of the thing, you know.
Listen, Jerry, listen.
And you also get to make some records that are phenomenal records that nobody ends up paying attention to.
True.
You know, that's
true.
Just, you know, and in my opinion, never diminishes the quality of the record or the music.
Yeah, it's so good. It's just that people, maybe some years later, they may get it, you know. Anyway, Jerry, let's take a little break and let's play some music. How about something from Toots and the Maytals? Or Toots, I've Got Dreams to Remember. How about if we take that?
Good.
Okay, Toots, I've Got Dreams to Remember. Master Control. Yeah, we're just waiting on Master Control to pull it up. And as soon as he does, Toots, I've Got Dreams to Remember. So that's number 9, Master Control.
I've got dreams to remember. Nobody knows how I'm feeling sad. All I know, I walked away and cried.
Yeah, was it COVID?
Yeah, I lost Toots to COVID.
Mm-hmm.
It was a real tragedy.
Mm-hmm.
Toots was, I think Toots is one of the most underappreciated artists that's come out of Jamaica, despite the fact that he's so well known. Because what people don't realize about Toots, and that was one of the things we were trying to do with this record, Toots in Memphis, Toots is one of the greatest soul singers that ever happened.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if Toots was born in America, he would have been on the top of the R&B charts back in the 60s, like, repeatedly. And what happened with this project was that Toots hadn't recorded in about 5 or 6 years. And Chris was extremely loyal to Toots. When I was at Island, we used to send a check every month to Toots, a couple of $1,000s. Had nothing to do with royalties, had nothing to do with anything other than Chris just wanted to make sure he was okay. And Chris came to me and said at one point, you know, we need to do a new record with Toots. And he was thinking about doing a record covering songs out of New Orleans because of the role that New Orleans had played in the development of reggae music. Because what people don't realize is that a lot of people that the one of the radio stations they were able to pick up in Jamaica back in the day was out of New Orleans. So they heard a lot of the 50s and 60s New Orleans music, Fats Domino, and Benny Spellman and the Meters and people like that, Professor Longhair. So he suggested that we look into doing that. And I spent the weekend going through songs, and I just wasn't feeling it. And I said at one point, I said, you know, I gotta listen to Toots again. And I spent about an hour or so listening to Toots records. And it just dawned on me, no, we need to be doing a soul record, not a New Orleans R&B record. We need to be doing a soul record. We're gonna go to Memphis, you know? And I pitched the idea to Chris, and he loved it. So we put together the band. Was supposed to be Sly and Robbie as the rhythm section. And Mikey Chung from Peter Tosh's band, and also Compass Point All-Stars on rhythm guitar. And Larry McDonald, whose resume is longer than my veranda, was the percussionist. And then we were bringing in, we were going to go do it in Memphis in an analog room at Arden Studios. Jim Dickinson, who had been in the Dixie Flyers, one of the bands that played behind Aretha Franklin's records, he was going to produce the session. We were going to use some players from Memphis as well. And Ry Cooter was supposed to come in from L.A. to play guitar. Sly and Robbie ended up getting a Japanese tour, had to leave. We had to reschedule, so he didn't happen. And Eddie Hinton, who was a big R&B player from Muscle Shoals, joined the sessions. We went into Memphis. We had a week to do the record, so we had 3 days. We had, well, 5 days, five business days. So we had 3 days to do the basic tracks, and then 2 days to do overdubs. And most of, practically every, I don't know that there's any song on that record that isn't a first or second take. It was all done live in the studio.
Wow.
Toots, you know, obviously did his vocals, we would redo his vocals, and Robbie would come in and plug into the board and redo his bass lines sometimes, but basically it's a live record. And it was a match, it was magic. Teeny Hodges, who had been Al Green's guitar player and wrote a lot of the song, Al Green's hits with him, we brought in to also play on the session, and him and Toots got really tight. They ended up writing a song, the last song on the record, See Things My Way.
Mm-hmm.
And then Teeny ended up joining Toots' band for about a year, went on the road with Toots. It was a great record. It got nominated for a Grammy. Ironically, a lot of people thought that I won a Grammy for that record. It wasn't. And when I finally did win my Grammy, which was about 10 or 15 years later, and maybe almost 20 years later, and everybody was coming up to me, I'll never forget that night, congratulating me on my second Grammy. Now you got one free chance. You know, and I kept on saying, no, this is the first one, and they just didn't understand what I was talking about.
Jerry, the one that really and truly was your Grammy, what record was it for?
Well, it was for, by that time I was doing reissues and catalog kind of stuff. So I was working as an independent producer for Sony out of New York.
Mm-hmm.
And it was, we did a 5-CD box set, mm-hmm, of About the Blues to be done in conjunction with a documentary series of films about the blues that Martin Scorsese executive produced on PBS in America.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, for me, it was a labor of love because that's where I started. I started out blues, with blues, mm-hmm, and working with blues musicians, mm-hmm, when I was really young. And it was a fantastic project because it was a joint venture between Sony and Universal. And between the two of them, they own probably 90% of what matters in the world of blues historically. So I had a lot of goodies to play with, and got to sort of put together my dream blues playlist, you know, and over 5 CDs, and it was great, and I was really happy to see that it got the kind of recognition that it did, because I think if somebody, you know, had to take a crash course on the blues, and they sat down and they listened to those 5 CDs, they'd get it.
Mm-hmm. So Jerry, it really seems like if that club in New York did not lose their liquor license, I mean, your life might have gone a different way. That exposure to music, I mean, all this great music was amazing. Go ahead.
Yes, yes, in the sense that it would have made it harder for me. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. But I was fortunate because I grew up in a home. My father was into jazz. He used to listen to a lot of jazz. Mm-hmm. My mother liked a lot of classical music, mm-hmm. but also loved Billie Holiday. Mm-hmm. Paul Robeson was a mm-hmm. big, you know, my parents were very politically active, mm-hmm. Involved with the civil rights movement. And, I went to a summer camp every year when I was a kid, where a lot of the counselors were people that had also been involved with the freedom rides in the Deep South.
Got you.
And had come back with blues records. That's how I first heard Muddy Waters and Howlin' Wolf. A counselor at the camp had brought these records back from Mississippi. Mm-hmm, you know, but the club, the Cafe Agogo, not having a liquor license, was great because at 14, 15 years old, it gave me a way to get into clubs. And by the time they sort of hit their demise, the Fillmore East opened up in New York, and that was a big theater, and they didn't have a liquor license, so it didn't matter how old you were. And by then I was in high school. And but the other thing is, I was very fortunate because my mother realized at a very young age that music was my passion. And she basically encouraged me to pursue what my passion was. Mm-hmm. Even though she wouldn't let me pursue my passion really in drumming, which is what I really wanted to play. Mm-hmm. But my parents didn't really consider the drums to be an instrument, and they didn't get it. And mm-hmm. I was very frustrated. I have to go over to my friends and go into Manhattan and a friend of mine's basement in his building and play on a set of drums that were there. And then I injured my hand and I sort of couldn't play for a year. Mm-hmm. And then I started hanging out around professional musicians, and I just thought, I'll never be able to play as good as them, forgetting the fact that they were in their 40s and 50s and I was 15 years old.
Right.
So, there was a lot that came into play. And like I said, being in New York, even in terms of reggae, in the 70s, late 70s, New York was just like every night. It was, the Wailers, Peter Tosh, the Mighty Diamonds, Dennis mm-hmm. Brown, Gregory Isaacs, mm-hmm. The Abyssinians, Culture. You name it. They all came through, and it was a great town for them to play because mm-hmm. there were so many Jamaicans in New York mm-hmm. that, it just kicked it up another level,
Of course.
This thing that used to happen at the Wailers shows in New York was just, I think I mentioned it when we were talking the other day, but the Rasta community used to hang outside, mm-hmm. And wait for the band to come on. So you get all of these, because predominantly the crowds most of the time in reggae back then were mostly white kids, So you'd have all these white kids there in the venue, and then the band would come on stage, and then all of a sudden it'd be like sort of like Moses parting the Red Sea, and the Rastas would come
forward,
in, mm-hmm. like going to the front of the stage, and it would just lift the band, mm-hmm. because they would just feel that, that
connection,
and it just was something special. And I was fortunate enough because I knew I was friends with a fair amount of Rastas in New York at the time, that a lot of times they let me hang in the mob. And, and so, it was just, I saw so many shows with Bob and phenomenal shows. I saw a Gregory Isaacs show, I remember, on a rainy Tuesday night in Irving Plaza in New York. There was hardly anybody there, and it was Gregory Isaacs and Roots Radics, and Gregory just burned the place down. Mm-hmm. It gives me chills just thinking about it.
So, Jerry, somebody just messaged me and says, maybe they didn't catch it at the beginning, they said, who is Jerry? So let me just say one, if you tune in late.
I've been asking that same question for a long time.
So we're talking to Jerry Rappaport. He is a former A&R executive at Island Mango Records back in the heyday of reggae and African music with that company. And of course, he's a Grenadian now. He lives here in Grenada. Involved, you may have seen him with the Grenada Hotel Association, isn't that right? GHT?
Yeah, I've been involved with the Hotel GHA? Association. Mm-hmm. I'm also involved with the Flower Growers, the Flower Arrangers and Growers Association of Grenada, because mm-hmm. that's my new passion, uh-huh. Is flowers.
What kind of flowers are you growing?
Well, I'm up in the mountains, so I do a lot of heliconias and gingers, mm-hmm. Because that's sort of conducive to where I am. And, you know, I'm blessed to have a nice piece of property that I was able to find at a very reasonable price back in the time when nobody wanted to live up where I am.
Right.
And,
in the bush.
But, you know, and, yeah, I'm in the bush. And I mean, if you had me on the first segment, you wouldn't have been able to hear me. It was raining so heavy up here that, you know, I was listening to you with my iPhone up to my ear so I could hear what was going on. I kept on saying, oh, come on, man, let this rain go away before Eugene tries to talk to me. So,
yeah, man. So that's Jerry, yeah. Jerry Rappaport. It's good to have you here, man. Jerry, let's take some music. How about Burning Spear? Recall some great men. So, Master Control number 10. That is Burning Spear. Recall some great men. Some great men who've been fighting for our rights. Great track. I always love Burning Spear. So conscious, so rootical, I call him. And Busy Signal did a remake of this song not too long ago. Quite nice, but there's nothing like the Burning Spear version. Tell me your connection to Spear
Spear was signed back Mango. You know, Spear originally was released internationally on Island. Back in the 70s, late 70s, I guess it was. And then he left the label for a while. And then he came back into two records in the late 80s. And by then, you know, Spear was pretty much a self-contained unit. Mm-hmm. You know, he was, and that's one of the things I always had a lot of respect for Spear about, is that he was really on top of his business mm-hmm. end of things. Mm-hmm. His wife was his manager. In this case, there was an issue, but that's not always a great recipe. Mm-hmm. It's actually one of the things that Chris once made to me about don't sign artists who are represented by their spouse.
Family, yeah. Creates problems.
In any case, you know, and it was great. I mean, I didn't spend a lot of time with Spear. I spent some time in the studio with him when he was working on the record, and he's just such a pro. I mean, you know, all I can say is I have so much respect for him, both as a man and as a musician. And I think that his catalog and the songs that he's written really sum it all up for, you know, the place that he holds in the pantheon of reggae music.
Oh, yeah. And, you know, one of my favorite Spear songs, Throw Down Your Arms and Come. Oh, that was So yeah. Seeing him perform that, that was just, that did it for me, man. Wow. But I mean, all his music, you know, 400.
It's interesting. Mm-hmm. Here has that depth, mm-hmm. you know, there's a certain thing that he has that certain people have. Thomas Mafumo out of Zimbabwe, mm-hmm. Is somebody that reminds me of Spear in a lot of ways. Mm-hmm. Just that same kind of depth as a musician and as a human being. And so, just can't say enough about Spear and also Nelson Miller, who's his drummer and sort of his right on for a long time. And phenomenal guy as well.
Right. Tell me now, a little bit, let's fast forward to Grenada. And actually, before we come to Grenada, let's fast forward to who are some of the reggae artists that you see today that have impressed you? Jamaican now. Let's go to Jamaican and we come to, Jamaican artists who impressed you today.
There's a lot, actually. I think this is sort of the second renaissance of reggae music, personally. There's more good young artists out there than I've seen or heard in a really long time. People like Jesse Royal. Personally, I think Jesse's the top. When I saw Jesse here, when we brought him in for the Pure Grenada Music Festival, mm-hmm. Afterwards, I was talking with Jesse backstage because Jesse sort of tracked me down. He wanted to find out who was this guy that told them to sign me before anybody knew who I was. Because mm-hmm. I had heard his one song that was sort of popular, Monday Judas.
And I just
started digging for songs, and the more I heard of him, I was just really impressed with not only his ability to write, but also his ability to sing and sing Jay and you know, all of this kind of stuff. And then when I saw him perform live, and I just saw the presence that he had. And I saw him about 2 months after the festival here in New York. And what I saw in New York just reinforced what I believe, that he just has got this something special going on. Mm-hmm. I think he's really, really great. I like Chronix a lot.
Of course.
Although I must confess, I like Chronix's earlier stuff more than some of his latter stuff. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I feel like some of his stuff's getting a little overproduced. Mm-hmm. I like John Ine. I think mm-hmm. she's mm-hmm. really
talented.
Just a mm-hmm. real got a lot of interesting stuff going mm-hmm. on. Mm-hmm. Protege, mm-hmm. Coffee, mm-hmm. Lila Leakey, yeah. and you know, Taris Riley. I mean, you know, I don't think you can not have a conversation about modern day reggae right now without mentioning Taris. Mm-hmm. I mean, his last record album, Healing. Mm-hmm. is just a fantastic record that speaks to the times we're living in both, deals with both despair and joy and hope. And I think he's rare in that regard. I think he's making, the other thing I find really exceptional these days is the quality of the productions that are coming out of Jamaica.
Oh yeah.
Just the level is just
phenomenal.
Skyrocket. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. The fact that now, you know, you can do a video on an iPhone, you know, basically, I mean, it's just made it so much more viable for everybody. Because, you know, back when I was working projects, when video became a big element, you know, if you were going to do a video, you were looking at adding $100,000.
Oh yeah,
to a budget. Easily. Most of the time. Mm-hmm, you know, mm-hmm, and sometimes that was more than you were spending on making the record.
Right.
You know, so that was sort of hard to justify. And the other issue that happened, that a lot of musicians don't realize this a lot, and you know, is that, you know, I had guys come into my office and go, oh, we have to do, you know, two or three videos. And I look at them and I go, you know, you do realize you're paying for the videos. And they were like, well, what do you mean? I'm like, you know, yeah, the record company puts up the money, but it gets
you gotta pay it back
against your royalties.
Right.
I said, so you're basically setting yourself up to never see a dime from your records, mm-hmm. you know? And I think that's one of the things that I find a lot of people don't understand. They don't understand the nature of the beast of the record business and the music business.
Jerry, if you could speak to that again, speak to that a little bit more for the artists listening and exactly how that worked and still works if you want to connect with a traditional record company. The advances and taking it back later on, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is that a lot of people think that once they get signed to a record company, they've got instant success. You know, I mean, like back in the day when I was doing A&R at Island, you know, I mean, if you were a reggae musician, even if you were an African musician, the fact that, you know, I was an A&R guy from Island Records, Bob Marley's label. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. They would be like, you know, mm-hmm. I had guys wanting to sign contracts before they even read the contracts. Mm-hmm. You know, and I would say to them, no, you got to take the time, man. You got to go see a lawyer. You got to mm-hmm. look at this contract. You got to understand what you're signing your name to. People don't, they didn't understand the business. Mm-hmm. And they would encourage the company to do all sorts of things. I saw managers come in and put demands on the table that would result in their artists never seeing a dime of royalties for as long as they live.
And then they blame the company and all that. Mm-hmm.
You know, and the return that they were going to get from it was so negligible, it really didn't make any sense. Mm-hmm. And I mean, I mentioned this the other day, the only artist that I ever really worked with that really had a super strong understanding of the business was Arrow out of Montserrat. Mm-hmm. Arrow was the only guy who would come into my office in New York mm-hmm. and sit down, and he'd turn to me, he'd take out a pad and say, okay, what are we doing, Mark? What's going on? Mm-hmm. What are the results? What's going on with promotion and publicity? You know, whenever I had an interview set up for him, we needed anything done, he was available. I had other artists that would, you know, you'd call them up and say, I got this interview set up for you tomorrow. Oh, I can't do it tomorrow. I got something else going. What do you have going on? They couldn't tell you, you know. And then the same artist would come into your office, you know, 3 months later and complain they weren't getting any publicity. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I've always advocated, especially the young musicians who are first getting started in this business, that they have to learn the business, mm-hmm. all right? And they have to be very careful when they sign their name to anything. Mm-hmm. Because I have seen contracts down here where people were ready to sign themselves away for 15 years mm-hmm. without really realizing what they were doing, mm-hmm. okay? And I highly recommend before you sign your name on a piece of paper to sign yourself over to anybody for 15 years, you do your due diligence mm-hmm. and you make sure you know what you're getting involved in. Mm-hmm. And I think you see that with the artists that really make it. And most of the time, the artists that are very successful are the ones that have good management. And people who are getting good advice, who are surrounded by people who aren't just yesing them, people who are willing to say to them at times, no, that doesn't make sense. No, we can't spend another month in the studio. We've already blown through, you know, oodles of money. You know, these are realistic things, you know. You know, so I think the business side of the business is as important as the musical side of the business.
Jerry, I don't know how much you have time to take in a lot of local music, you know, here in Grenada now. But are there any local reggae artists that kind of caught your attention, or you know, you've?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think very highly of my good friend Patrick Delves, mm-hmm. Akeem, mm-hmm. Ryan Paul. Mm-hmm. I used to like Don Silver's sort of Maxi Priestess kind of stuff before Don F. Mm-hmm. A few years back. I don't think most people think of her as a reggae artist, but when I've heard Laura Lisa do reggae, uh-huh. I've been very impressed with her. Mm-hmm. But I'll be honest with you, Eugene, I don't go out a lot.
Right.
I spend so many years being out all of the time.
No, you're staying, huh?
I live in a home that I love being in, and I'm busy. And to get me to go out, it's got to be something special. It's got to be really motivated. I mean, I do go. I'm going to go tonight to see Sabrina up at her Treehouse concert for mm-hmm. a second time because mm-hmm. I really enjoyed it the last time. Mm-hmm. One of the things I really enjoyed about it, quite frankly, is the fact that because everybody has headphones on, mm-hmm. nobody's talking during the music.
Oh, that's good.
This is
that's nice.
One of the reasons why I don't go out a lot.
Yeah, everybody talk. Everybody listen to the music.
Mm-hmm. Because everybody's there talking, and I'm standing there going, hold on a second. Why did you bother to pay for the price of the admission if all you want to do is talk? Mm-hmm. You can do that at home. You can do that at a rum check.
True.
You know what I mean? You don't. And this isn't just endemic to Grenada. I encountered this in the
state. All over.
It's the combination of that and the people that just want to record everything on their cell phone. Mm-hmm. instead of being in the minute themselves. Mm-hmm. They want to, they're more intent on what they're getting on their cell phone so they can go and show all of their friends what they were at. And in all honesty, they weren't really present for the event in the first place.
So true, Jerry.
And, and it's sad to me because, you know, when I was coming up, and I mean, I used to go to shows, nobody talked. Mm-hmm. And it was like being in church.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, and everybody just paid attention to what was coming off of that stage and soaked it in. And afterwards, you might have a lot to say about it. But I just, this new world.
It's different, huh?
Because, and I don't know if it's because when we were growing up, we didn't have all of the other diversions. I mean, music was one of the few diversions that we had. We didn't have video games. We didn't have, you know, cable TV. You know, I mean, we didn't have a TV in my home when I was growing up until I think I was about 10 mm-hmm. or maybe 8. And even then, we were only allowed to watch it for an hour a night. You know, but I mean, I could go into my room once I had my first little mono stereo hi-fi system, and you know, I could close the door to my bedroom and I could listen to my 45s mm-hmm. and listen to albums, and you'd hold the record cover and you'd look at it. And, I mean, that's all you paid attention to, you know, and now I don't feel that most people consume music that way. I think it's become background
music
for a lot of people. Mm-hmm. So as a result, when they go out to see live music, they're in that same headset, you know. Mm-hmm. Oh, it's background music. I'm going to chat with my friend.
And it's kind of so disrespectful for the artist, to the artist too. You know, you put note what you have, you sit, you know, and then people are just talking and chatting. It's very disrespectful to a performer.
Well, I mean, I tell you, there were artists that I know in the 60s that would have walked off the stage. Mm-hmm. I mean, Nina Simone, somebody like Nina Simone.
Or Miles Davis or somebody.
Like that. You know? So she would have just turned her back on the audience probably and preferred her back to the audience all
true.
The time.
True.
So, but. And I talk to a lot of musicians, and they all have the same complaint. Mm-hmm. You know, that especially here in Grenada, they say they hate playing in clubs, in restaurants and whatnot, because they feel like nobody really is paying attention. Everybody's just sitting there drinking and gabbing and carrying on.
Mm-hmm. Jerry, let's hear a little bit of a long time I haven't heard this, actually. A little Arrow. How about Arrow, Groove Master? You said you were always very impressed with Arrow's business sense, huh?
It was the first record that I signed when I was at Mango.
Oh, yeah? Excellent. Well, let's definitely play that. So Master Control, that's number 11 on your list. Groove Master by Arrow. Jerry's very first record that he signed at Mango.
Keep on grooving.
Always on top of his game, huh?
Yeah, well, I was, I'll never forget when we went down to the studio in Bed-Stuy to hear the track, and I was just blown away, and I was just really, like I said before, I was just blown away by him as a person. Mm-hmm. I really enjoyed working with him. We got really close. Matter of fact, he bought the band. He was gigging on tour in the States. He was up in Boston, and they drove overnight to come down to New York to play at my wedding.
Wow, nice.
At a club. It was great. I mean, it was really sad when he died. It was a great loss. I think he would have continued to make really interesting music because he was like a sponge. Mm-hmm. He just absorbed everything. You know, every time he came into New York, he'd come to my office and ask me for all the new African things and Brazilian things that I was working with and or that I knew about. You know, he just wanted to know what was out there and always willing to try new things. And it was just him, and I was really glad I got to work with him. The person I regret not being able to work with in that same world was David Rutter, who we wanted to work together. But unfortunately his management decided to have him sign with Sire Records. Mm-hmm. And they did two records and they dropped them, and it was just one of my big regrets. I never got to work with David because I just think David could have been really huge. Mm-hmm. Outside the world. I mean, I remember the shows that I saw back in Charlie's Roots days. Mm-hmm. I mean, that was just phenomenal stuff, and Dave is a fantastic songwriter.
Oh yeah, amazing talent. One of those special ones, very, very special ones.
Yeah, and also a special human being. I mean, just a really special person.
Mm-hmm. Jerry, tell us a little bit about, we have about 5 more minutes, but just wanted to touch a little bit on some of the African music you'd have worked on with Mango or Island.
Sure. Mm-hmm. I was hoping we were going to come back and do another show about that sometime. I mean, you know, like I said, when the whole world music thing blew up, mm-hmm. I mean, I had really gotten into African music at that point because I was sort of early dance hall just didn't do it for me. Mm-hmm. I just found it musically really limited. And then at the same time, there was this African music scene developing primarily in Paris that was using state-of-the-art studios and making incredible records. And this new generation of African musicians were combining the elements of traditional African music with contemporary instrumentation. So it was just incredible, I found, and visually exciting. And mm-hmm. The first person I saw that in that world was King Sunny Ade. Mm-hmm. Out of Nigeria. Which was a totally new experience. Mm-hmm. And Fela, also from Nigeria. Mm-hmm. But then first time I saw Youssou N'Dour from Senegal, mm-hmm. that was a real eye-opener, and I really fell in love with Senegalese music. So I ended up, we ended up signing Baba Mal out of Senegal, mm-hmm. who's another incredible human being. He's got a law degree, he speaks about 8 different languages, and he's a brilliant musician. Ray Lima, Thomas Mafumo from Zimbabwe was a really a signing that I was really proud of because I felt that Thomas Does music deserve to be heard by a wider audience? His music had been the soundtrack, more or less, to the liberation movement in Zimbabwe. Mm-hmm. And then as Mugabe became who he became, mm-hmm. Thomas basically had to leave Zimbabwe mm-hmm. and ended up moving to Portland, Oregon, ultimately, where he still is living. Mm-hmm. Because as he said to me the last time I spoke to him, he said, all my children grew up here. They don't want to go home. What am I going to do? You know, and then between that and the fact that they legalized weed in Zimbabwe was enough to keep Thomas there. But Thomas was just a really deep musician. I think there's certain places in the world that are spiritually extremely, have a lot of depth. I think Mali in West Africa is one. I think Zimbabwe in South Africa is that. I think Cuba is that in mm-hmm. the Caribbean in a lot of ways. Mm-hmm. And it just shows up in the music and the strength in the music. Salif Keita was an incredible musician to work with out of Mali. You know, he came from a wealthy family and he wasn't from a griot family, so it was not accepted for him to sing. Mm-hmm. Also, he was an albino, mm-hmm. and in West Africa at the time, most albinos were killed at birth, mm-hmm. and were looked at as outcasts, and he became the voice of Mali, mm-hmm. and had an incredible career, and you know, a very tortured soul, because I think of the abuse that he had growing up, but a brilliant musician at the same time. And then the other African that I really spent a lot of time working with and really loved working with was Mongani Ngema from South Africa. He was the person who wrote Serafina. We met when Serafina was on Broadway. It was a hit show on Broadway, mm-hmm. and we did a record with him in New York using the cast of Serafina as background singers. And we spent a lot of time together, and through him, I got to know, you know, other Africans, ladies with Black Mambazo and Marion Makeba, and was present at an extremely moving moment with Nelson Mandela. And, you know, so, I mean, it's, you know, Africa, there's an incredible amount of music coming out of Africa. There was, I think, in the 80s, what was coming out of Africa is almost like the heyday. But now there's, you know, with the Afrobeat scene out of West Africa now, oh, it's just incredible for me to see. And I'm thrilled to see what's happened, that the Africans and
Caribbean
sound, the Caribbean mm-hmm. sound has
blending.
Come together. Mm-hmm. And there's this commonality and this mm-hmm. this crossbreeding going on and stuff. And it's just so long overdue, you know. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know, I remember once when Thomas Mafumo turned to me, and Thomas got a very deep voice, and he said to me once, well, you know, Jerry, reggae music is African music. We have beat in Africa. Mm-hmm. And I said, I turned to Thomas and I said, that's probably true, Tom. Mm-hmm. I don't doubt you for a minute, but I guarantee if you said that to a Jamaican, you'd get a real ear. So,
but it's all one, you know, music, right? All one music, you know?
Mm-hmm. And it was a big thing for the Africans when they mm-hmm. came to America. It was very sad for them when they would perform before mostly white audiences. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then when I was working with the Bundu boys from Zimbabwe, and they came, we played Prospect Park in Brooklyn, and they came out on stage, and the audience was predominantly Black, and they froze. They were shocked. Yeah. And I remember Biggie, the lead singer of the band, looked over at me on the side of the stage, and I just went like, go for it, man. And they just kicked in, and they just had the whole audience in the palm of their hand, and they were just ecstatic when they came off stage. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that's very encouraging to me to see how, you know, when I see a video of Alicia Keys doing a song with Chronix and Protégé,
right, right,
and knowing how the reggae artists wanted to be accepted in the R&B world back in the day,
right,
you know, so to see that finally happen, it's just really encouraging to me, and I think it's going to just lead to more and more exciting and interesting music happening.
Excellent. Well, Jerry, it's on the top of the hour. It's almost 12, 1 minute to, according to what, actually it's 12 right now. So listen, we're going to end off right where we began, and then it fits into exactly what you were saying. We started off with Dionne Blaize doing her Coochie Dongo thing, which really was the soundtrack, or the beat came from Namibia, and here she is, a Grenadian American artist, So we're going to go back and end with that track, Master Control. We're going to end with Coochie Dango, but we'll take a look for it now. But Jerry, thanks a lot for sharing all your great experience with us, with Grenada, and the world, everybody who's listening to the program. It's really good that, you know, your experience is something that I'm sure many people may not know. They see you walking around and they don't know who you really are, but hey, I know who you are, Jerry.
So, anonymity is sometimes.
I know, man. It's not a bad thing sometimes. But anyway, it's really great having you on the program, Jerry, and thanks for spending your time. I know you gotta go take care of your flowers now, so please.
I got to go help at a charity flower sale, actually.
There you go. Very cool. So, hey, thanks again, man. And Master Control, let's pull up Coochie Dango, Dionne Blaize, to go out. Take care, Jerry. All the best.
All the best, Eugene.
Yeah, Master Control, where are you? Yeah, just...
Greenz Music to the World is brought to you by Gittens Pharmacare, the pharmacy that cares. Halifax Street, St. George's. Natural Cool, Spiceland Mall, Grandans. Cool clothes for cool people. The Computer Store Grenada Limited, Spiceland Mall, Grandans. The Gamers Paradise, with headsets by Razer, Conair, JBL, Sony, Astro, Logitech, and more. And Island Catering, without a doubt, the best food and catering service on the island. Pharmacare, the pharmacy that cares. Halifax Street, St. George's. Affordable access to care, a wide range of prescription drugs, medical supplies, health and beauty items, diabetic testing supplies, immune system support products, vitamins, supplements, and lots more. Visit us today or call 440-2165. Ask about or call in prescriptions, discounted items, and special delivery requests. Gittens Pharmacare. Care, convenience, expertise. We've got it all.